Arizona Theater Matters, in white text on black. With generous support from the Lyman Fund and the Living History Foundation, present Heretic, the Mary Dyer Story. June 1st, 1660. A jail cell in Boston, the Massachusetts Bay Colony, 7 o'clock in the morning. ASL interpreter Dawn, a blonde woman in black blouse, begins signing.
I'll hang today or I'll go home to my family. I'll sleep in my husband's arms, or I'll swing at the end of a rope. My choice. Can a wife be pardoned for such inconsiderate madness? That's what he called it, my fine and loving husband. We wed the 27th of October, 1633, my happiest day. I wore heavy white silk with glistening embroidery. My veil was designed by my intended, the milliner. He was dazzling in autumn velvet, the finest legs in London, a head taller than most men, and that splendid face. His dark brown eyes met mine, and I was blind with tears. We joined hands, and when the priest pronounced us married, William turned to me and took in my whole countenance. He kissed me with a promise of love and protection for that day and always. I felt myself becoming warm and blushing, distantly aware of our family and neighbors watching us. Later, after the banquet, we took to our marriage bed and stayed in it a week. So happy were we. So in love. Our gladness died before we saw 2 Octobers become November. Our first anniversary feast was a funeral. Quiet in my belly. Quiet in birth, quiet at my breast, his head warm and sweet as he drank so gently and slipped away without a sound. I woke to find him cold in my arms, and he baptized just 2 days. He was called William after his father, little angel. Went straight to God, says the church. The church. We were good Anglicans. We came to the New World in 1635 not to leave the faith, as did the pilgrims at Plymouth 15 years before us, but to reform it. To bring the faith to a simpler land and plant pastoral seeds whose fruit could be taken back to Old England to nourish St. Martin's and then the whole of the church. William read to me a letter from Francis Higginson, already in New England. This is the most healthful paradise, clean, dry air, springs of sweet water, lush woods, harbours, islands, fat, juicy deer, turkeys and fish, pumpkins, parsnips, carrots, turnips, large and more luscious than any we have ever seen in Old England. Word followed that poor Francis had died of consumption that winter. We came to Boston in late summer, having sailed in spring, Samuel just beginning to show in my belly and William with his mind fixed on our lot on Summer Street. He spent his days drafting and revisiting his designs for our house. The ship tossed during the sunlit hours. The nights were rough and relentlessly dark. How he drew straight lines, I'll never know. When at last we stepped onto the land, we stood together in a deep embrace and felt Samuel stirring, now more than five moons grown inside me. Boston, green beyond description and teeming with promise. Only 5 years before, some 200 Europeans died here. The winter was so harsh. We arrived when the days were long and warm, so the men had time to fell trees, strip and mill them, and to put up fine houses before the first frost. We passed muster with the preacher and were admitted as members of the Congregational Church so Samuel could be baptized the day after his birth on the 20th of December, 1635. I lay with Samuel in my arms, William's arms round me and the hearth a comfort wrapped round the three of us. My dreams were dancing scriptures, Psalms and Isaiah, Ezekiel and Esther, Ruth and the Nativity. Simple days, simple thoughts, hard work and good, honest sleep. Love was our yoke, and behind us, buried in the churchyard, were our sorrows. In time, though, the words of the ministers invaded my sleep.
People must accept the place in society into which they're born. Some must be rich, some poor, some high and eminent in power and dignity, another mean and in subjection, all standing in need of one another.
I said to William, what kind of ministry is this? How are we better off than in cold-hearted London? To break any of the Ten Commandments is to be condemned to death. More than half the people in Boston are deemed unqualified to take communion, and their children can't be baptized. Not baptized. Condemned for all eternity? Innocent babes? We moved across the world to experiment with simpler ways, to purify the church, for unquestionably the Church of England was corrupt. All candlesticks and incense and beautiful windows and music. Beyond the walls of the cathedral were horrors so hideous. Public disembowelments carried out with the supervision of men of the cloth. People burned at the stake. We escaped Europe's brutality only to find Boston a torture chamber. Poor wretches in stocks, soiling themselves in the open air. People whipped publicly, the bone showing white, the red blood running down their backs. The Reverend Roger Williams suggested that the Ten Commandments are in two parts. The first four speak to man's relationship with God and should not be subject to the laws of man. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Not make unto thee any graven image. Not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The six that follow are between man and man, and as such should be subject to the laws of man. Honor thy father and thy mother. Thou shalt not kill, not commit adultery, not steal, not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. I never understood how the tenth could be enforced at all. Never in my life did I hear anyone say, I do wish that fellow's house were mine, and I want his Eliza for me own wife. Who would say such things, and absent of them being said, How could one be accused? And even if one were to say, I wish I did have a servant like Mr. Wiggins, or that mule would be right useful on me farm, should one be punished for wanting? Just for the wanting? Is this not the very basis of our commerce? For his fanatical ideas, Roger Williams was banished by the governor from Boston. He went to Salem, where the people loved him, and went to his house for worship and counsel. So the governor tried to banish him back to Old England. He with a wife and two babes. Warning had reached him, though, and Reverend Williams was 3 days gone when the magistrate knocked on his door. Home was our sanctuary. We studied scriptures before the great fire every evening, our baby fat and healthy and our servants like family. We ate together, prayed together, and together we discussed our concerns about the cruel society beyond our door. How to suffer the sight of a neighbor in stocks for laughing on the Sabbath? For laughing. William, my most excellent, loving husband, ready to embark again come summer, back to Old England, was as miserable as I. How could our children live in such a world? Fetching water at the spring in April morning, I met my neighbor Anne Hutchinson. She was still bearing babes and already a grandmother. My friendship with Anne was immediate. We understood one another effortlessly, naturally. We opened our hearts to each other as if we shared one mind. Her love sustained me and does even now. Her father had translated the Bible from its original languages, Hebrew and Aramaic and Greek. He taught her that women are born equal to men. How discouraging is this Puritan preaching of the Old Testament, this Old Testament sifted and translated through the centuries by a relentless patriarchal lineage hostile to our sex. In Genesis 1st chapter verse 27, the original text says, "And God created the human being to resemble God's own visage. God created the male and female." Even King James agreed. The rib story comes later. Why do we need two versions of the creation? These great Christian leaders ignore the New Testament. Where are the Gospels, parables, and the Acts of the Apostles? What's more, they allow no reading of the Bible by congregants. We're to listen to them as sheep listen to the barking of dogs. No. A serene spirit coming from the awareness of grace within acquaints one with the truth. Kindness is the way of grace, and women and men are all part of God's universal community. Here were words that made sense. I knew as well as I knew my name that I hadn't crossed the sea to listen to fire and brimstone in the church. But to hear Anne's warm, clear voice that sparkled like the spring water bubbling forth. I ran home and found William splitting logs in the yard. We must not return to London, William. Such things have I heard today. He laughed and gathered me up in his arms and carried me into the house. So relieved was he to see me happy again. I told him about my new friend, and we sat before the fire and talked and laughed and cried until Samuel slept in my arms. Our dinner was cold and the servants had gone off to bed. Every day save the Sabbath, I met Anne at the spring. She put in plain words the sermons and the lessons, and soon Dorothy Brenton, Sarah Cotton, and Mary Coggeshall joined us. Soon our numbers were in the dozens. Anne invited us to her house Monday evenings when the church sermon was fresh in our minds. She shared her ideas about a covenant of grace, and we asked questions and discovered the answers together. When I returned home after each meeting, I told William what I had learned. One night, as we watched Samuel sleep, "Mary, is there a place for a man at your Monday night meetings?" I threw my arms round his neck and was never more glad to be married to him. Anne's house soon overflowed on Monday nights, so she held a second meeting on Thursday nights. She brought light and comfort to fearful hearts. As I do understand it, laws, commands, rules, and edicts are for those who have not the light which makes plain the pathway. He who has grace in his heart cannot go astray. She was a preacher and a teacher, and she was a woman. Anne Bradstreet, forbidden by her magistrate husband to attend our gatherings, wrote her frustration in poetry. "I am obnoxious to each carping tongue who say my hand and needle better fits. A poet's pen all scorn I should thus wrong, for such despite they cast on female wits. If what I do prove well, it won't advance. They'll say it's stolen, or else it was by chance." Women, speaking of God and poetry. All about the town, people, women, men, even children, declared the wisdom of salvation by grace. The barber, surgeon, publican, and ferryman sought out Anne's counsel. She served as our spiritual guide, not by election, nor by sanctimonious appointment, but by grace itself. The multitudes flocked not through obligation to the mount to hear the great sermon of Christ, but by spirit alone. Never was a place more beloved than Anne's house midwinter, with the fire roaring, cider in the pot, cinnamon and clove on the air, and we women friends all in a circle with our needlework. Everything made sense then. The home, the hearth, neighbors, our husbands, babes, the work in our hands, and Anne's words that gave a name to the knowing that we were living natural and good lives in the sight of God, tending our families and homes and our spirits. We felt God's pleasure with every stitch. Grace woven into the fabric of our lives. We cared for each other, loved each other. Never did I before, or have I since known such peace. It wasn't long, though, before the governor declared that Anne
bred disturbance in civil affairs. There shall be a day of fasting and humiliation to repress the diverse opinions of the colony. No form of worship other than Puritan will be tolerated.
It was October, and every maple was lit up as if on fire. Life had been growing in my belly again for more than 7 moons. I knew this child would come in December, sharing a birth month with Samuel. I felt her spirit as she grew in my belly, as I felt the spirits of all my children. We shared our heartbeat. I felt joy grow within me, pulse by strengthening pulse. Joy was, perhaps, the greatest crime I could have committed. The babe in my belly moved, though something was different that day, and then the pain came, and though I had a garden to reap, I stepped inside and lay down on the bed. I tried to sleep, but the pain grew stronger. I retched and called to Alice, the kitchen maid, to run find Anne Hutchinson, and
She came to me with Goody Hawkins, another midwife, who gave me basil, dill, and mugwort in a tea. William came home, and I told him to hold my hand and stay by my head. Gripped his hand and screamed into his chest, and he held me, and I told him to leave and begged him to stay. And after days, it seemed days, I pushed with all my strength, bursting every vessel in my neck and eyelids. And I fell back, drenched and gasping. And I heard Anne whispering to William that it was a girl and something else. Something else. She swaddled the babe and gave her to William. I said, "Her name is Elizabeth Joy." He wept and took her out the door, and I closed my eyes and slept. When I woke, William was there with me. Anne and Goody Hawkins had gone to bury our Joy in the Boston churchyard. She had no head, but a face atop her shoulders and two ears, and was dead when she entered this world. The governor, magistrates, and ministers could never know. They would proclaim that Joy's lot was God's punishment. We vowed never to speak of it. Of her, our baby girl, our Joy. And we never would have. But 5 months later came the trial of Anne Hutchinson, when it seemed the whole world knew and I was branded. Mother of a monster. The governor sent for Goody Hawkins, and she brimmed over with lies. She gave a horrifying description. A face without a head, horns, two mouths, and claws for feet. The governor wrote letters to church leaders throughout New England and around the world, telling them that I, a heretic, had given birth to the devil's child. Last century, a famous surgeon wrote with absolute assurance that
there are reckoned up many causes of monsters. God's immense power may be manifested to those which are ignorant of it, and God may punish men's wickedness. Monsters are also occasioned by the craft and subtlety of the devil.
Anne did not agree. She said there are no monsters. We all come into the air innocent and perfect. God doesn't punish us. God is infinitely merciful, and what God has created cannot be perverted except by the wanton lewdness of men's imaginings. The day of Anne's trial, both my William and her husband, also called William, were elsewhere, off doing business. The men of the church and state knew this was the case, factious poltroons. Men looked on Anne from everywhere in the room, in the pulpit, in the gallery. Heartless, humorless men surrounded her, and she huge with a babe in her belly. Hours she stood, answering questions, matching their fierce biblical quotations with citations of love and compassion. She staggered finally, and I took to her a stool. Anne then stood hours longer. Finally, she questioned them. What rule in the Holy Writ makes it right for elders of the church to question one in my confinement, pretending they sought light, but seeking to entrap me in mine own words? I looked about me and saw not sympathy on our neighbors' faces, but curiosity. The ministers declared that Anne was
a very dangerous woman to sow your corrupt opinion to the infection of many. You have stepped out of your place. You have rather been a husband than a wife, a preacher than a hearer, and a magistrate than a subject.
I look at her as a dangerous instrument of the devil.
Anne was by then nearly dead on her seat. I spoke rashly and unadvisedly. I do not allow the slightings of ministers, nor of the scriptures, nor anything that is set up by God. It was never in my heart to slight any man, but only that man should be kept in his own place and not set in the room of God.
Liar! I do cast you out! I do deliver you up to Satan! I do account you from this time forth to be a heathen! I command you in the name of Christ Jesus and of the church as a leper to withdraw yourself!
All the ministers then turned their backs and she was excommunicated. The congregation turned their backs. I rushed to her side and took her hand, and as we walked out of the church, we heard someone ask, "Who is that with Anne Hutchinson?" A voice cried out, "She is the mother of a monster!" The congregants gasped and whispered. My knees gave out beneath me, but Anne caught me and shouted back at the crowd, "The Lord judgeth not as man judgeth. Better to be cast out of the church than to deny Christ." Then we were in a carriage, then somehow home in front of the fire. Anne had her arms round me sobbing up every sorrow of every mother ever accused. I was an abomination. I had brought forth the issue of the King of Hell. I, named for the mother of our Lord, wedded St. Martin's, I was to be shunned and outcast. Anne rocked and spoke to me, though she was weary beyond imagining. "We must turn inward for strength, Mary. Look upwards for light. Our quest in this unkind world is not for ourselves alone, but for all of the religious homeless. Stay thy course, Mary." And she rocked me until I fell into a sleep.
Wait in the stillness. Wait, let the gathering unite. Wait in the silence.
If we'd all just let Boston be, we'd all be alive today. Living in a ghetto of our own, among ourselves alone. I need only promise never to return to Boston, and I avoid the gallows, and perhaps die at home among my grandbabes. I am not afraid. I've had the rope round my neck before, bound at the ankles and wrists, kerchief over my face. Governor Winthrop was both prosecutor and judge at all of our trials back in those early days. He and his magistrates scowled at us, a flock of grumpy old grackles. 75 families they banished in one fell swoop. We survived, much to their most grievous perturbation, and we owe it all to grace. We went to Providence, Rogue Island, they called it, inhabited by us heretics. Though we began from nothing, living in mud and wooden huts, then clearing the land and building our homes, we were all of us free to think and say that which our hearts compelled us. The natives treated us well, extended kindness, willingly shared the secrets of their survival. They befriended us, though many a white settler despised them for savagery. Then sent out edicts that our friends be savagely slaughtered, male, female, babes, all. We needed the Narragansett families to guide us and teach us how to live on the land, as they had done forever. Unlike us, they built new homes every year, one for summer and one for winter.
The winter homes were longhouses, and 20 families lived together in them. The summer homes, wigwams, were at the beach, made of walnut bark over curved green wood. Everything was round, no sharpness in the home save the instruments used for cutting and cooking. No shelves as we had, but baskets and pots made of barks and grasses. The generosity of our new friends knew no bounds. Any of us from old England who were hungry, thirsty, or sick found hospitality there. How silly are we in our corsets, with our imports and exports and powdered wigs. Narragansetts know how to live with only what they find growing out of the earth or flying above it, swimming in the water and wandering the land. We were frightened by wolves. The Narragansetts were prey not for the wolves, but for the whites, the English, Dutch, and French, who measured the value of trees in lengths of boards and the value of land in pounds and shillings. For our countrymen and European brothers, Narragansetts were a nuisance, like gophers in the barley. For a time, a moment, Providence was safe for them and for us. We were a peaceful people for a time. Narragansett women spent their monthly terms in little houses just for them, with their sisters, mothers, and grandmothers attending them. There were times in the early days when I longed to run there and be sheltered from children and husband and neighbors, to be only concerned with praying and resting in quiet, but to leave husband and children in the care of servants. I had a fine house built by my fine husband with the help of our fine neighbors. William and I have an uncommon kind of marriage, and have since our joy was lost. My heart changed then, or my wits did. I had 5 more children and loved them as if from the moon. Their nurses were more mother to them than I. Our Mary came easily. Then William, named for his brother in heaven with the angels and called Will to distinguish him from his father. Then Meyer, short for Meyer Shalal Hashbaz, not my idea. Some day, Meyer, thou must make thy father explain to thee his thinking, encumbering thee with such a flubbery name. It may have been a good name for Isaiah's son, but in this modern day... Next came Henry and finally Charles in 1650. Though I carried and birthed and nursed them, they were not so much mine but God's children. I couldn't look at them but think of the wretched world into which they were born. I could hardly look upon little Charles at all. When I began to have thoughts of drowning him and myself, I knew I was mad. That was all of it, and unfit for motherhood. What kind of horror was I to entertain murderous thoughts toward mine own newborn babe? This shall I take to my grave. I have heard tales of women who have disclosed such secret thoughts. Mothers who gave birth 24 times in 16 years. Mothers who threw their babies from bridges, smothered them with bedclothes. Mothers who pulled out their own hair, cut themselves with darning needles. Such women are put into places dark and infested, places where the jailers are themselves criminal. Murky, close places fit only for those deemed unworthy to live in society and walk among the decent. What right have I to be mad? William adores and respects me, and always has since the first day he saw me. I was the most fortunate of women, and yet, when I lost Anne,
When in 1642, after the death of her husband, she moved to Pelham Bay, I lost my best friend, my midwife, my teacher, my sister, and my mother even. As we packed her kitchen things, she said, "I can't stay here, Mary. The place is haunted by the memories of my William, best friend I ever had, my heart. I can't sleep in that bed without him." Back when the Boston establishment persisted in visiting their home, begging him to renounce Anne's doctrine of grace, her husband told them,
"That I shall not do. I am more nearly tied to my wife than the church, and I look upon her as a dear saint and a servant of God."
I would that I had that devotion to my mate, but alas, when I lost my joy, I lost my joy. And William put babe after babe into my belly, and forth they came into the mean world without me in the whole of my mind to hold them, to feed them, to sing them into this world as every mother should. Anne's friendship was my rock. After she moved away, the days felt interminable. I found solace in her few letters, her precious written words. How soon, though, came August 1643. Four babes and I in the kitchen. It was harvest time, and we were making food gifts for our neighbors. Samuel sat at the table's head, twisting rushes and wild hemp into lengths of rope. Will then coiled them into little baskets, as we learned from our Narragansett friends. Little Mary put in one of the bright pompions from our dooryard garden, an ear of corn and a tiny loaf of bread. I, with muskmallow ribbon, tied the thing together, and Baby Meyer happily banged on a table with his spoon as we sang. The kitchen maid stumbled, sobbing through the garden door. "What is it, Alice, for heaven's sake?"
"Mistress Anne is dead, madam. Scalped, butchered, and burned with the house. Before they killed her, madam. Before they killed her, she watched us as servants, and five of her children was bound, scalped, and hacked to bits."
"Holy Mother of God." I threw the children onto the bed and told Samuel not to let the baby fall. I ran out the door and through the garden gate and down the back road to find William. He had already heard the terrible news. The town was awash in the horror of it. Algonquins, in retaliation against the settlers who had massacred their people. They didn't know Anne, didn't realize she was their friend. Oh, revenge. How ghastly thou art. How absolute thine enmity. Some back in Massachusetts viewed it as God's final judgment of her blasphemy. The Puritans celebrated Anne's gruesome death. They declared it wondrous evidence of divine providence. Governor Winthrop wrote, "Mrs. Hutchinson was an American Jezebel who had gone a-whoring from God." I lived through the 7 years that followed her death as a shadow moves across the yard mid-afternoon. A slow, quiet path and a melting to darkness. Day after day, becoming weeks, then months and years. When baby Charles was born, I knew I would never lie with my husband again. Not so long as I could bear children. I could not bring yet another soul into this dreadful world. The midwife put Charles to my breast, and in his dark little eyes I saw my own darkness reflected. I could think only of dropping him in the well and myself after him. William loved to watch me nurse my babes. He set his hand on my shoulder and stood behind me as I rocked Charles. William bent down to kiss me on the side of my neck and I cringed. His touch felt loathsome to me then. His desire repulsed me. And I wanted to sail away, a world away, back to old England, far from him and his persistent seed.
I dreamed I took my babes to the sea. They were small in my dream, all of them little again. Samuel, Mary and Will, Henry and Meyer just learning to walk, and tiny Charles in my arms. We walked on the sand in my dream into the shimmering waves. We kept walking until the water was over our heads. My feet were heavy and I walked on the bottom and we looked up at the bright blue sky above the surface. Anne came floating up with a mournful face. She pulled Charles from my arms. I tried to resist, but she was too strong. She drifted away and my children went with her. I tried to call out, but I was underwater and I couldn't open my mouth. I wanted to follow, but my feet were so heavy and my skirts felt heavier and heavier and I couldn't move my legs. I couldn't reach the surface, I couldn't go back, and I couldn't move forward, and I couldn't bear it another second. I had to breathe, I had to breathe!
I heard stories of a new manner of worship emerging in England. People were moving away from the Anglican Church as William and I did. But they were dissatisfied with the Puritan answer. The new group was called Seekers, and their motto was, better not to stand still, but keep searching with an open mind. An open mind. Charles was only 3 months old the day I kissed him on his head and put him to his nurse's breast. I packed my bag and put on my woolen cloak, kissed goodbye all my babes and my husband, though many a man would call me criminal for doing so. William was distressed, but didn't stop me. He kissed me, touched my hair, and bade me take good care of myself. And then I went. Had I spoken? What I would have said, no matter how intended, would have sounded sharp and unkind. So bleak had my mood become. I boarded the ship at Newport and set sail for Old England. A woman alone. Time stopped. I felt nothing. Nothing for my husband and babes left behind me. Nothing for my fellow voyagers. I slept and ate, though very little. I prayed and smiled and nodded my head when it was expected and proper. I heard the voices of the other passengers and the crew. I heard the wind and the gulls that followed us. I cared nothing for any of it, and wondered why I was there, the tedious sea in all directions. I lay awake nights and listened to the creaking of the ship in rhythm with the rolling waves. I wondered why I lived. When we arrived in Old England, I visited friends whose faces I had not seen in more than 16 years. We were all older and grayer, and they ever gracious and glad to see me, but their concern was clear. For a woman doth not leave her family, much less her newborn babe, unless something is grievously wrong. I embraced my old friends, and they me, but we didn't speak of it. And like a hedge of cattails, it stood between us. The seekers met in the fields outside London. No stained glass windows, no crucifixes or chalices, no vestments. They stood or sat quietly, listening to the sounds about them. The air, birds, the small creatures and the rustling grass. I took up a daily habit of meeting seeker friends out in the field behind St. Martin's. I journeyed with a friend the 100 miles to Swarthmore Hall to hear the man they called King of the Seekers. His name was George Fox. His words, like yours, Anne, were sensible and tender, and his eyes were like torches. Oh, Anne, you'd have loved him. He said that all people carry the light of Christ within them. He called his new religion the Children of Light. Free thought and respect between men and women. All may be silent or speak when the Spirit compels them, even during meetings for worship. Simple meetings between human beings and God and the earth and sky. For the next few weeks, I took to walking alone in the Swarthmore orchard. In the quiet, I felt myself breathing in rhythm with the wind. My blood moved with the pulse of the brook. I felt a deep presence, something of which I was fully a part. At once, I understood the precepts the Narragansett women had shared with me. From violent storms, our orchards cleansed. Dead leaves blow into piles that crumble into smaller bits, become earth and from which new trees sprout. The seasons through which we all move, the newness of spring, the fullness of summer, the abundance of autumn, and the dead of winter. It's all sacred. It's all divine. All. She was no monster. She was divine. She is divine. There is a mysterious perfection there. Oh, Anne, help me to see, help me to know. Help me to know how to leave William, the most extraordinary husband. I hope someday he meets George Fox. Maybe then he'll understand. George took me to a school he started where the little children learned planting and tending flowers and vegetables. He showed them how the shoots were born and grew and flowered. He wanted them to recognize the same process inside themselves. And each season they could look within and feel the shifting in themselves. That was the day he said he thought I would be a fine minister. I knew right away that I had been called to do so. All the elements of my life, all my sorrows and all my doings had led me to England and to Swarthmore to meet him. Though I was a woman, he said my sex was not an abomination, as said the Puritan fathers. Neither was it beside the point. It was important and would feed the faith.
I was a mother and had known life growing inside me. And I had known grief and I knew grace. In time, I met in England many other Quaker women who ministered to the sick and poor. We fell into a sisterhood as daughters of the light, no less blessed than our brethren. We had the benefit of truth to guide us. As Anne's father had taught her by way of the original texts of the Bible, women were not held up as original sinners. The church fathers so defined us. How convenient for them. Half the souls on earth are fit only to be submissive to their bidding. Women cannot have a calling to guide worship. On a rainy day at Swarthmore, with a fire roaring, we friends gathered, making plans to spread the truth more widely. The truth that everyone carries the divine within, and no one has authority over another's piety. I had been in England for years. Though I knew it seemed unnatural, I had no intention of returning to Rhode Island to my children and husband. Not to Rhode Island should I return, but to Boston with other friends, and defy the rule that no free thinkers were allowed in the Massachusetts Bay Colony. Only by standing up in the face of injustice could we shed light on the darkness and show to the world the pure path to grace. It was our calling and we were eager to follow it. I did return to Boston with my friend Anne Burden. The ship's manifest showed a Q for Quaker next to our names. We thought this harmless and charming. If one died at sea, the funeral could be designed according to one's faith. Thoughtful, don't you think? We arrived in Boston Harbor on a bright, frozen day in late winter. We gathered up our things and stood in line as the magistrate spoke to each disembarking passenger. When we arrived at the front of the line, the man looked up at us sharply.
Quakers? Marshal!
A rough hand grasped my arm, and it was all I could do to stay on my feet as he hurried me to the jail and unceremoniously dropped me onto the filthy floor. I never saw my friend Anne Burden again. All my books and papers were burned. Quakers were not welcome in Boston, not even for an instant. Nothing had prepared me for the gloominess, dankness, and cold of that cell with the windows boarded up. I had no way to tell William I was so close to home. 2.5 months they kept me there. Only because a jailer took pity on me and gave me paper, pen, ink, and a little lantern did I find respite, writing every thought that came to me. Scriptures, over and over again. Romans. The sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. The voices outside the jail taunted me. They were free to roam about the city, going to market, shouting to each other across the square, talking, laughing, sometimes singing. They were laughing at me, at all people in chains, all slaves, all wretched and powerless people of the earth. But then I woke from a fitful sleep with an urgent idea. They might know of me, or might have compassionate hearts. They might help me, if only they knew I was just on the other side of the wall. It took some doing, but I pushed a note through a crack in the wood. I repeated the Psalms, all 150 of them. It became my task to remember them in order, and with the quill the jailer had given me, I marked the passing by scratching lines into my legs. And once I had finished 150, once I said, "Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord." I started once again. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of the sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. I heard a key in the lock, and the door to my cell swung wide. My husband stood there, the light at his back. He was a great shadow. My eyes had grown unaccustomed to the light that pierced them, and I covered my face with my hands and struggled to stand. He carried me into the rising morning light. There in the street, he kissed me and in his great embrace enfolded me. It was the most comforting earthly moment of my life. Some kind soul had picked up my note and passed it on, and the word had quickly reached my husband. William had gone to the governor of the Massachusetts colony and demanded that I be let free. Though he had been put out of Boston, William had since become respected by all for his prominent station in Rhode Island. The governor dared not imperil the alliance between the two colonies, so he ordered my release. But William was put under bond and swore that I, his Quaker wife, would go home to Rhode Island straight away, with no lodging in any town of the colony, no speech with any along the way, and I must never return to Massachusetts. He gave his word. So glad was I to be away from that cell that I didn't wonder what price might have been paid for my release. Even had I known then the promises he had made on my behalf, I do not know that I could have resisted the allure of the bright world beyond. Right away we were off, me on a chestnut mare and William on a bay stallion. It felt like a dream, riding through the morning dew and into the afternoon. My filthy hands gripped the reins, and though I felt weaker than ever in memory, I did manage to hang on. Once we had taken leave of the Massachusetts Bay Colony and entered Rhode Island, we rested the horses. William put down a woolen blanket and we ate there in the bright meadow, and it was the most savory feast I'd ever tasted, a piece of chicken and a bit of bread. He pulled from his pocket a handkerchief wrapped round fresh mint. I gobbled the leaves and welcomed the stinging taste. I rinsed my mouth with creek water and tore a rag from my petticoat to scrub my teeth. Then he put his arms round me. We had been years apart, and my fertile seasons were behind me. I hadn't expected to feel carnal pleasures again in my life, but here was love and ecstasy without the fear of pregnancy. It was a hard day of travel, more than 50 miles, but our horses were strong and we arrived home as the sun set, turning gold on all the rooftops of Providence. The garden had grown dense and mature. I bent down to smell the lavender that grew just outside the kitchen door. When I stood up, there was Samuel. He was a majestic man of 22 and married to Anne's granddaughter. She was named for Anne and so much like her that I wept. And she kissed my cheek and called me mother. My little Mary came to me, and she was a woman of 17 and the mistress of the household. She kissed me too and said to me, "Welcome home, mother." Anne took my hand and led me to the great tub in the kitchen. The men were gone, and my daughters peeled the layer of rubbish from my body. Mary threw into the fire the foul rags that had been my day dress, petticoats, corset, and shift. They recoiled when they saw the scabs on my legs, but quickly set about making me clean again. It stung like the dickens at first, but they scrubbed me with vinegar and poured a pitcher of it over my head and through my fetid, tangled hair. Anne rinsed my hair and skin. Then I stepped out, and they wrapped me in a thick blanket and put me before the fire. Mary rubbed into my legs, cracked feet, and hands oil of rosemary. Anne patiently brushed my hair with boar bristles and braided it. I went to bed feeling as if nothing was so lovely as clean linen. The children came in to see me. In came 16-year-old Will Meyer, who was 11, 9-year-old Henry, and the baby Charles, who was 7. The youngest two didn't know me and peeked at me from the doorway, a curious woman in their father's bed. Still, they called me mother and smiled, both of them little images of their father. I felt welcome. But I was a stranger to my children. And the house was unfamiliar. I couldn't give it thought, though. I was so weary that I closed my eyes and slept for 3 days. I woke to find William watching me, his head on the pillow next to mine. He put his hand on my face, and we touched each other's lids and brows and lips. And in silence, we reacquainted ourselves. His face was a map of laughter and sorrow, the corners of his eyes wrinkled from 10,000 smiles. Deep lines had settled between his brows. I kissed those spots and he kissed mine. I knew then that my face had acquired a kindred landscape. Hungry? Off to the kitchen we went. At the table before the fire, we ate eggs and bread and hominy and drank strong tea. Finally, we spoke of the hard stuff. He told me of his promise to the governor of the Massachusetts colony. I cannot be silenced like a misbehaving child. Would you have rotted in that cell? Would you have never seen your children? Please! People are being tortured. I must go to Boston again and visit the other friends in the jail and give them comfort. What a natural hold on you have, these Quakers! They have taken you from your family and in you put a wish to be hanged. You cannot survive in Boston. He banged his fist on the table. But William, they have given me back our joy. He put his head on his arms and wept. I knew I couldn't help him understand then. I was asking too much of him. I put my hands on his shoulders and my cheek on his hair. Shh, husband. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Enough now. I kissed his brow, pulled a shawl round me, went out to the garden and walked through the town. Gone were the woods that once ruled Providence. In their stead were a sea of chimneys, and masts of ships of all sizes and descriptions filled the harbour. I saw no familiar faces as I walked through the streets, but felt calm in the free city. For 2 years I stayed home with William and tried to be a good wife and mother. But Mary had become the mother. So I held meetings for Indians and slaves, and those were heavenly times. They are natural friends. How much they taught us, those who were stolen from their homes in Africa, yet carried love and grace in their hearts, and the friends who are even now displaced in this new world that is their ancient home. How forgiving are they? My son Will began attending, and soon called himself a friend. Some friends who were landowners began to free their enslaved and bonded servants, too.
But when I heard of increased persecution of friends in Boston and learned that in jail were William Robinson and Marmaduke Stevenson, two young men beside whom I served the sick and poor in London, I knew I had to return. They could not suffer there alone. I did go to Boston and met outside the jail another dear friend, Christopher Holder, also there to visit William and Marmaduke. We fell into elated discussion, and because of our bright clothing, we stood out in Puritan Boston like scarlet maple in a forest of black spruce. We were dragged into the jail as prisoners ourselves for violating our banishment. Christopher was, for his highborn background, put on a ship for England. I was brought with William and Marmaduke before the exasperated magistrate.
We have tried several laws and endeavored in several ways to keep you from among us. And neither whippings, nor imprisoning, nor cutting of ears, nor boring of tongues with hot irons, nor banishing you upon death would keep you from amongst us. Give ear and hearken now to your sentence of death. You shall be had to the place from which you came, and there to be hanged until you are dead.
The will of the Lord be done, Marmaduke said.
Marshal, take them away!
Yea, joyfully I go, said I. We were dragged back into the jail then and scheduled to hang in a week. We all wrote to the magistrates. I recommended that they read Proverbs, for surely they had missed many messages therein. The merciful, kind, and generous man benefits himself, but he who is cruel and callous brings on himself retribution. Oh, Anne, I could never rise to thy eloquence, but I tried to help them understand that their kind of rule could not survive. Better to change the law and save their own souls. I relished my time in confinement then. In the silence, I felt deeply peaceful. It was my choice to be there, and with each moment, my spirit grew in confidence and strength. I knew Boston would rise up and change the laws, for surely they would not allow the governor to murder a woman guilty only of speech and thought. The day dawned when I was to hang. I felt no fear. I sat in that cell waiting, listening to the drum. The jailer brought a visitor, and I turned to see, standing there, my son, Will. He rushed to me, hugged me, and lifted me off the ground. Oh, Will! Oh, Will! And I hugged his neck. Then I remembered, and panic engulfed me. Will, thou art a Quaker. Thou art not safe in Boston. They'll hang thee, Will. We spoke in the manner of friends, Quakers. So, thou art ready to hang, mother? Is it not more potent to see a son hang beside his mother than to see her hang alone? No, Will! This cannot, this shall not be! Thou art 18 years old. Thy life lies before thee. I have lived and known love and sorrow and joy. I have sailed across oceans and searched for this path on which I go to the gallows today. This is no whim, Will. Hast thou considered thy living family, mother? My father sits in the yard and weeps. He weeps for thee, puts his face in his hands and sobs and is inconsolable. While thou skip down the path to thy death as if thou had no care on earth, thou art killing thyself, mother. Yes, thou, with a husband who adores thee above God himself, with six loving children, thou left us without even a goodbye. Were my father to come here, he would lose his own freedom, and who would care for his family then? He has written to the governor 3 times, mother. 3 times he has pleaded for thee. He speaks of thy comeliness, the neighbor's love for thee, and for thy generosity of heart. Where is thy loyalty to him, mother? Where is thy generous heart where my father is concerned? The governor has granted thee a reprieve, but thou art too stubborn to accept it. How can I, Will?
Shall I let two innocent men go to the gallows without me simply because my husband is a powerful man in Rhode Island?
I stand here instead of my father. No one in Boston knows me as a Quaker. I am here on behalf of all thy children. Henry is 11 years old. Charles is only 9. How is he to face a life knowing his mother would rather hang than spend her days with him? He has hardly seen thee in his life. How is he to make sense of it, mother? Hast thou given any thought to any of us other than thyself? How selfish art thou?
Forgive me, son. Forgive me. Please. Though thou might never understand what thy mother has done, know that she did it to make a better world for thee and for thy children too and their children. How can I live in comfort, enjoying my children, my garden, the love of my husband, and the breathing world, while people are being tortured?
In time things will change, and thy grandchildren shall know thee.
I have children in heaven, Will. They've been waiting such a long time. My boy looked down at his feet and kicked at a piece of straw. I put my arms round him and he wept.
Mother, please. Please. How can I return home without thee?
More than anything, at that moment, more than anything in the world, I wanted him to go. Will, I said, thou art my son and my friend. I will see thee soon.
He picked me up and kissed my face. Then you'll come home.
I took a breath and smiled and touched his cheek.
I will to the magistrate, he said, and then ran out the door.
For the first time, I felt guilt. The shame that I had suffered for my sex, my selfish choices, secrets held for reasons only of survival and self-preservation, all paled in comparison to the raw guilt of that moment. Seeing my son overjoyed, believing he'd prevailed heroically, saving his mother from the rope. William Robinson, Marmaduke Stevenson, and I walked hand in hand to the gallows. Because they were men, they had been tortured, their ears sliced off, their tongues burnt through with hot irons. Then they had been whipped twice each week for 9 weeks. They never cried out, nor spoke ill of their persecutors. Their heads were high as we made our way. First, the marshal compelled William to climb the ladder, then bound his legs and wrists, put a kerchief over his face. The drum went silent, and he was dead. There was no sound save the breeze until the drum pounded again, and they hanged Marmaduke as they had our friend William. When the time came for me to climb the ladder, I felt pressing on me the shame of the crowd, and I knew that the sight would be terrible, and those who turned not away would demand changes in the law. They bound my ankles and wrists, and on my neck they put the noose. They put the kerchief on my face. The drum stopped. But instead of feeling the ladder pulled away, I heard shouting. I was reprieved that day, though I stood on the ladder and refused to climb down.
Finally, Marshal Michelson picked me up and carried me back to the jail. There at the door stood my son Will, weary sadness in his eyes. He knew I had not turned from my mission. These past 7 months I have mostly spent at Shelter Island, walking on the shore and listening to the waves hit the sand and watching the greedy gulls scratch and peck at each other. I returned to Boston without telling a soul. Once again I am jailed and condemned. Once again, all I need do is vow to stay out of Boston, and home to my family and friends I go. I'll hang today, or I'll sleep in my husband's arms. My choice. Our point of faith, we friends, is that the truth makes men tender. Here is my choice, then. Either I expose this immediate truth, that the powerful in Boston who wield the sword will strike me down for defying their banishment decree, or I return to Rhode Island and let the mean world sort itself out. My banishment is imposed because of my thoughts and my words. I have broken no commandment. I have taken nothing away from anyone, but refuse to bow to that human authority I cannot recognize. These men hold our lives in their hands. We have condemned our children and their children by our cooperation to lives of obedience and servitude to indefensible oaths and creeds to which their hearts have no natural allegiance. How dare we? Our children don't belong to us. They belong to God. They must be given the chance to feel the light in their own ways, in their own time. Heresy! Yes! I joined a new religion, and for that I will be hanged unless I choose to leave Massachusetts and never return! How can I? Is it not a sin, once I know the truth, to keep it to myself? Is it not my duty to mankind to share the truth so they may be made tender? Is my one little life so precious that I cannot offer it in sacrifice for the lives of the multitudes of souls that follow me? The killing of a mother at the hands of the state will make a mark. I am guilty of thought. I am guilty of speech. If I don't do this, free thought will die here before it's born. That men have gone before me is not meaningless, but less compelling only because they were men. And somehow more dispensable than we who carry water and bear children. Boston will see me climb the ladder alive, and they will watch the life go out of me. My grave will be unmarked, and my family will have no claim to my body. I stand before history today. Thankfully, in New England, these events are solemn, and not celebrations as we have seen in old England. I have seen too many hang to hold much hope I won't spit or soil myself. Still, I trust I am a vessel filled only with grace. But once released, I am in heaven and my body belongs to the earth. May it feed the worms. They're here. Marry again, William. Wed thee a new bride who brings forth new children and warms thy feet by the fire. In October, with my babes in the garden, plant holly, evergreen, like thy love, William. Thou never wavered. I shall see thee today, Anne, and my little Will, and my joy. I choose to go now to the gallows. I am free.
Fade to black. Fade in white letters for my fine and loving husband, Dan. Text begins scrolling upward. Don Schoenberger, nationally certified ASL interpreter. Jeanmarie Simpson, playwright and voice. M.K. Riddell, director. Kevin Tai, sound editor and engineer. Hoot Williams, pianist and composer. Lindsey McHugh, sound designer. Scrolling continues. Acknowledgements. Heretic was originally commissioned under the title Mary's Joy by the Boulder Friends Meeting Peace and Social Justice Committee in Colorado. The play premiered at the Boulder Friends Meeting House in May 2011, directed by M.K. Riddell. The piece subsequently toured under the care of the Pima Friends Meeting in Tucson, Arizona, and was presented at the Friends General Conference Gathering in Providence, Rhode Island on July 4, 2012, produced by Chuck Fager. Infinite gratitude to M.K. and Chuck, Vern Thiessen, and Dylan Brody for edits and insights. Deepest love and thanks to Shannon Kane, my dramaturg, for literally working with me backwards and forwards through the script, line by line, and making it better. Thank you all the friends, far too many to name and too many I would forget to name, who looked at the script as it evolved through interminable drafts. Thank you all the historians who made the scarce details of Mary's life available for research. And to Brooke Shields for her candid, honest, personal insights about postpartum depression and postpartum disorder. Thank you all who contributed to the crowdfunding campaign for the world tour that came to an unceremonious end at Heathrow on Valentine's Day, 2015. Thank you especially Doug and Sherry Smith, Bill Robison, Barbara Lee Olson, Angel Miller Tanner in Heaven, Reno Friends Meeting, Joseph Galata, Donna and Bill Murphy Sharp, Beth McCleary, Betsy Fidali, British friend John Sheldon, Canadian friends Susan Andrews and Mike Mancuso, artist friends Ellen Stern Epcar, Sydney Tesk, and Bobby Catula. In Reno, thank you my dear friends Corey Cooper, Kelly Brundage, and John Frederick. Thank you GLM Theater, Christopher Daniels, and Joe Attic for your tremendous support. Thank you, John Perovich and the Now and Then Creative Company, Phoenix, Arizona, for the staged reading in January 2018. Thank you to director Pamela Sterling for your beautiful and insightful staging, and to actor Laurel Ann Porter for realizing so thoroughly and in so short a time the character of Mary Dyer. Thank you, Tony Biggin and Alec Davison, for permission to use your beautiful song, Wait in the Light. Thank you, Mary Dyer, for your life and for giving it up for us all. Jeanmarie Simpson Bishop, October 29th, 2020. Wait in the Light. Music copyright of Tony Biggin, 1983/1991. Lyrics copyright of Alec Davison, 1983/1981. Heretic, The Mary Dyer Story. Copyright 2019 by Jeanmarie Bishop. All rights reserved. No part of this publication may be reproduced, distributed, or transmitted in any form or by any means, including photocopying, recording, or other electronic or mechanical methods, without the prior written permission of the publisher, except in the case of brief quotations embodied in critical reviews and certain other non-commercial uses permitted by copyright law. For permission requests, write to the publisher, addressed, Attention, Permission Coordinator, at the address below. Fellowship of Quakers in the Arts, (FQA), 1515 Cherry Street, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, 19102. www.fqa.quaker.org. Performance licensing, all rights reserved. No part of this publication may be read or performed in any form before any audience without the prior written permission of the author, except in the case of brief quotations embodied in critical reviews and journalistic features. To request permission, please contact the author through the publisher at the address above. Fade out, and on a white circular logo with clean line flourishes. Inside, it says ATM Productions, Radically Inclusive Theater, with the word radically horizontal in the center of the circle and radiating lines above and below. To the right, a round Arizona Theater Matters logo, white with three spotlights, yellow, on a brown cactus with the title in brown below it. Final fade to black.